a brief summary of Auchnetree. We are a company of 200 plus employees, and we have been into this software development from last 10 years. We have 10 years of credibility, and we identified we were the best 50 best Indian companies by Silicon Review in 2017, and we are the Microsoft Silver Partner. We have a Microsoft Silver Partnership, and we are a Accenture Select Partner. And we have a partnership with Xamarin and IBM as well. And our primary focus within Auchnetree is to provide best customer user experience through a good design development, and improve overall, give the a good business value to our customers as a business strategy. Okay. And we are the leading provider for the cross-platform web and mobile application development. Yeah, let's move on. So I just want to cover very high level, because this topic is the cloud for beginners. So I was expecting some of the people who are beginners into the cloud, who want to understand the cloud. So that's where I felt that having one a slide talking about relevance of cloud. So how cloud is relevant in the current business environment. So this topic talks about that. So you see the statistics part of it. So 90% of enterprises, a business enterprise, are connected to cloud in some form. Okay. So you see that any enterprise, big enterprise, is some way or other way they are into the cloud. Okay. If you are an enterprise, you're not connected to the cloud, that means you'll not be able to stay competitive in the current business environment. Okay, that's the situation. And out of overall all the clouds, like 57% public clouds are taking. So public clouds means like AWS, Azure, Google, IBM, and 43% private clouds. That means people have their own environments. So that's the trend. But what's happening over a period of time, that a public cloud is going to take a bigger space, and private clouds may shrink. Okay, that's the trend, because a public cloud, they're providing a wide variety of services where enterprise will be able to quickly develop and reach out to the customer and customer quickly compared to the private cloud. So that's where, so we see a trend that public clouds are going to increase their footprint going forward. The next, in 2019, the expectation is that there will be around $2.14 billion market in 2019, and it is going to grow for another a couple of years with a 15% growth rate on average. Okay, may not be exactly 15 every year, but it is going to grow with a growth rate of 15%. For next couple of years. Slightly up. And other observation is that as the people got into cloud, when we take a feedback, they say that on average at 40% more cost effective. So when you say cost effective, we'll have to cost calculate just not only procurement cost of a device, a machine. It, when we compare like the cost of hosting it and providing a continuous power and providing continuous internet connection and keeping the people available to make sure that those servers are up and running, and some automated services that are available. So when you compare all those costs compared to on-premise hosting and compared to the cloud, so you see the 40% more cost effective in the cloud aspect. Okay, so most of the businesses are average. This number is average, not exactly for same every business, but average 40% more cost effective. Okay, the next one is this enterprise and cloud. They are kind of connected in a big way. Any big enterprise, they will have certain goals. They want to run with certain high-level goals of any business, and how cloud complements here. Okay, So enterprises wants to optimize time and cost. So they want to do a lot of things quickly and with a less cost. So that's where cloud enables them. Okay, cloud is known for that. Then enterprise wants to expand their business into different regions with ease. So that's where cloud facilitates that. Up slightly. Enterprise need speed and agility. Enterprise needs speed and agility, and cloud is designed for that. Okay, so any enterprise business without cloud, they will have a challenge for the survival. Okay, so with that in place, cloud is an important and it is going to play already playing and going to play a pivotal role in expanding enterprise business. So with this, I'll hand it over to Prayesh so that he'll be able to start with his agenda, a specific agenda for today. He will cover that.
Yeah, hi all. This is Prayesh here.
Go ahead, Prayesh.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, hi, this is Prayesh here. So I do have a complete 16 years of industry experience. Out of that, more than 5 years, I have worked in cloud computing. I have been the part of the cloud COE in the different companies as well. Yeah, and in my past, I have done the assessment, pre-sales, native development, actual migration and solutioning in Azure, as well as other cloud also, cloud computing services also. So in our agenda today, we are going to understand about the cloud computing and the different hosting models, which is public, private, and a hybrid cloud, and the type of the cloud services, which is IaaS, PaaS, SaaS, and all. And we will understand the cloud journey, how it has evolved basically, as well as the benefits of the cloud, which is cost, speed, global scale, productivity, performance, and reliability. So these are the factors. Why do we need to use the cloud, as well as the security in the cloud? Cloud computing. So basically, what is cloud computing? It is a servers, storage, and the database, networking, software, analytics, and more. The services which we get on the internet, that's called cloud basically. And the company which gives such facilities, they are called the cloud providers. And we can compare with the cloud provider and on-premise in this way. We can go ahead and take a electricity connection where we are going to have a capex actually. So what will happen that we are going to use it and pay it. So it's like opex actually. So in this, what will happen? We are using it and paying it. So operational expenses. So in this case, cloud is the opex. You are paying it and using it. You do not have any the large chunk of investment in that. Where if you go and have the on-premises, where we can have our own solar panel, we can have it, or we can have a borewell in our home where we can go ahead and fetch the water. So that will be become on-premises where you have a huge investment where you need to manage the complete borewell. You need to pay electricity for it. And if any issue is there, you need to fix it up. So it's a huge investment is required, as well as the management is tough for it. Whereas we can go ahead and get a water from some water supplier company and we can pay it as per our usage on the billing basically. So it's one of the comparison between the on-premises as well as the cloud. And some of the cloud providers, which are like well-known cloud providers, are the Microsoft Azure, Amazon Web Services, Google Computing Platform, and the IBM Cloud. Public cloud. So normally, whenever we talk when people cloud, they will be referring to the public cloud. So in public cloud, what will happen that someone else, a cloud provider, is going to manage each and everything for us. So in this case, what will happen that we will not be having any infrastructure, but they will be giving you the services and they will be managing it for you. So most of the 2/3 cloud providers, they are AWS, Azure, and the Google Computing and the IBM Cloud. So user will be paying it and they will be getting the services on the internet. They are getting it. A private cloud. So private cloud, what will happen? Normally, whenever we use it, we wanted to go with public cloud. The benefit of the public cloud is that we don't have to manage the infrastructure and everything is given by them. But due to whatever reason, if public cloud is not going to work for us, then we go ahead and use the private cloud. So in private cloud, what will happen that we will be having our own infrastructure and they will be giving a support to us. They will be giving a management to us. So some of the private cloud providers are the well-known cloud providers are Azure Stack, IBM Private Cloud or OpenStack basically. So always to remember it, wherever the public cloud is not going to work, then only we go with the private cloud. So some of the need for it can be like a data residency. It means what will happen that we cannot keep our data into other cloud provider boundary. Then what will happen? We will go ahead and purchase some servers. It may be costing lakhs basically. Only enterprise company only can have the private cloud. They can have it. They can go ahead and purchase the servers and they can go ahead and manage the infrastructure. And then the cloud will be getting, a cloud provider will be giving a services called IaaS and PaaS on the private cloud. Hybrid cloud. So hybrid cloud is the combination of the public cloud as well as the private cloud, or it can be on-premises also. So just you think, I can give you some certain example. Just you think that I wanted to keep the data into my on-premises. I can give an example. So which we have used it. So our usage was there that we have a SAP HANA database on our on-premises and we have used integration runtime in Azure Data Factory to connect it. And we have connected to the private environment or the network on-premises, we can say. We have connected it and then using the Azure Data Factory, we have taken the data to the Azure Data Lake. And using the again using the Azure Data Factory, we were able to read it, this data, and able to dump it to the SQL Data Warehouse where we wanted to have the massive parallel processing. And then the data was fed into the Azure Analysis Service for the modeling, and we were able to create a beautiful Power BI report. We are able to do it. So ultimately, wherever we cannot take a data or we cannot take certain facilities on the public cloud, then we go with the hybrid cloud approach. Types of cloud services, IaaS, PaaS, and SaaS basically. So infrastructure service, name itself is telling that in this, a cloud provider will be giving you only infrastructure. So what will happen that, they are going to give infrastructure, then we can go and have our services. We can go ahead and have it on these services. Can be like, we can have a .NET application. We can go and develop it over there or any of the languages which is not supported into the platform as a service because Azure supports only the almost around 5 to 6 language only it is supporting. So any of the language which is not supported into a platform as a service and we wanted to take this application to the cloud or any native language we wanted to, we are having it. In that case, we need to go and use the infrastructure service. So we can, whenever we are launching a VM, so in Azure, it is called virtual machine, in IBM cloud it is called virtual servers, in AWS it is called EC2 instances. So different companies, they use the different terms, but ultimately it is an infrastructure service. So whenever you are having a Azure VM, we can go ahead and have a Azure VM loaded with the SQL Server or .NET. So it's like pre-launched. Else we will having another option also, we can go ahead and take the VM, we can go ahead and launch it and we can have our SQL Server or .NET, we can go ahead and install it. So it depends on the need, whatever we have it, accordingly we can use it basically. So just to remember it always, software as a service is a superset of the platform as a service and platform as a service is the superset of infrastructure service. Platform as a service, again, I'm reminding it or reiterating it, platform as a service is nothing but a superset of the infrastructure service. Basically, in infrastructure as a service, IaaS, we need to manage it. It means the OS upgradation, security, we need to manage. That is the lacuna of the infrastructure service. Now, coming back to the platform as a service, which is known as a platform, as a managed service also. So in this, they are giving an infrastructure as well as they are managing it also. So in this case, user is exempted from the software upgrades, security patching, as well as disaster recovery, backup, and the business continuity. So what will happen, just to think that I have a SQL Server. So in SQL Server, what will happen? We don't need to install SQL Server, which is like Azure SQL V12, which is the recent version for Azure SQL. So Azure SQL, they could have installed it and we are managing it. Just we will be getting a connection string as looks like that it is installed into some other machines. So no doubt, definitely it is remotely. It is installed into some of the virtual machine into an Azure side. So we are getting a connection string and we will be connecting it. And then we'll be getting like a master database or other database and all. And we can go ahead and perform the different activities which Azure SQL is supporting it. Similarly, we do have another offering which is called Azure Web Apps, which is nothing but to create a website. So within no time, we can go ahead and create a website. We don't have to think for the infrastructure and all. And we can have the high availability, scalability, multiple things. We can go ahead and have it. Similar offering for the creating a website. In AWS, it is called Elastic Beanstalk. In IBM, it is called IBM Cloud Foundry App Runtimes. So again, wherever possible, we can go with platform as a service. And if it is not working, then only we go ahead with infrastructure service. Next, which is software as a service. So again, repeating it, software service is a superset of platform as a service, which is itself is a superset of infrastructure as a service. So now in this software as a service, some company could have already created a software, they could have developed it and we can go ahead and use it. So here, there will not be having any contribution from our side. Whatever the functionality and all they could have given it, we can go ahead and use it basically. This will be completely a browser-based application and we can go ahead and use it. So again, the benefit of using is this, that software upgrade, security patching and all will be exempting for us. So some of the examples are like Office 365, Box, Salesforce, Gmail, Dropbox and Netflix. So in what scenario we need to go with a software as a service? So in software as a service, where it can be always for the popular applications like an HR application, supply chain management applications, or like a well-known application. So like we can have Office 365 also. So ultimately it's very simple. It's like a business policy. Any company is going to create a SaaS product only if it is getting used by the mass. So they will be giving it and we will be going ahead and using it as per our need. And if required, we can go ahead and ask them to customize it. But if customization of a software is more than 25%, then no point in going with a software as a service. We can go ahead and develop an application with a platform as a service and we can develop it according with the from the scratch itself only. So this is the example. We can understand or the compare between the on-premises infrastructure as a platform as a service or software as a service. So in this, the left side, we can see this on-premises. In on-premises, we have an application data runtime, middleware, operating system, virtualization servers, and storage networking. So we'll try to get some example also in this so that we can understand it. So earlier days, we were having a on-premises where we can have an application just to think is like we have created a website like a testexample.com. So we could have developed an application which is like a testexample.com on a machine, a physical standalone machine. We could have developed it and this could be definitely having some data which we could have stored into a SQL servers. We could have used it or runtime which can be like a Java virtual machine or it can be a .NET. Middleware also can be like a Beanstalk or anything else we could have taken it. Operating system can be a Windows or Linux and it may be a virtualized also so that you can use the machine in optimum way and it will be definitely be having a server where it will be installed and all and a storage can be a tape drive or anything where we are taking some backups and all and networking will be required for us to completely doing the networking with a different system and all. So the problem is that in on-premises you are doing each and everything. So it's something like this, that we have a software company. Will we have any software company or will we be having a multiple company? So what normally they do it? They will be only managing the software. They are expert in the software development. So what they do? They will be giving a transport department to someone else. They will be some other third party company. They are giving help desk to some other company. The similar way they will be having some support persons and all from the hardware, software or the infrastructure. So they are giving it to third party company. So in that way, what they are doing, they are allocating the task to others. So the similar way we have an infrastructure service. In this, what we are doing, the above six component, which is like application, data, runtime, and middle, where an operating system is getting managed by you. It means the enterprise is managing it, whereas the infrastructure, which is like networking, storage, and servers, and virtualization, is provided by the cloud provider. So again, we'll take the example like a test example.com. So what will happen in infrastructure service? We could have gone there. We could have used maybe some native language. We could have used maybe a .NET also. We could have developed this application and hosted it on the IaaS server, or we could have used different servers also to install it. So that will be like an application data. We could have used it like, again, a SQL server of any version. We could have taken it, and runtime can be a Java, .NET. We could have used it, and middleware also can be Bistock or anything. We could have used it. Operating system also can be OS or OS. It can be Linux, or it can be like a SQL server, any version. We could have used it. So in this way, what is happening? Our burden on the enterprise is getting reduced. Now, coming back to the platform as a service, in this case, what will happen that runtime, middleware, and operating system is also managed by them. So it means we only need to go ahead and use some technology, which again, we can take it as a .NET. We could have gone and used a .NET version, any version. We could have taken it, and we could have developed an application, and we could have gone and published it as a web app. Right, we could have gone and published it as a web app. At the same time, if you wanted to use the data, we could have used the SQL, Azure SQL V12 to store certain data and all. Not only that, we could have used the blob to store the certain images or some other data and all, or we could have used Azure Data Lake to store the structured, unstructured, or the semi-structured data. Now, coming back to the software as a service, in this what is happening that all the components is getting managed by the well-known service provider. So here the user will not be having any control. They are only going to pay it and use it maybe on the number of the users kind of thing. So user is not having any thing to manage it. Ultimately hardware, software, and each and everything is getting managed by them. So whenever we do the assessment, we will be having a different approaches as per the understanding with the or the requirement. So this is the way we go ahead and use it. So some the company will be having in the approach to have the first priority as a software as a service, and the second priority as a platform as a service. Third priority can be infrastructure as a service, or the fourth can be a private cloud, or it can be a on-premises also. So here we have an example to understand with the pizza as a service. So whenever you are doing in on-premise, it means you are taking the complete overhead on ourselves. So here we can like have a maid at home. We are going to have a pizza. You are having it at home, and we are going to have it. In this, you need to manage each and everything from your side. So here the effort is much. Yeah. Now the next one, like infrastructure as a service. So in this, what is happening is like a take and bake. So in take and bake, what is happening over there that take and bake. So in take and bake, we need to have only a dining table, soda and gas and all to make it like hot or oven and all, fire and all. We need to manage it, and vendor is going to give you the pizza dough or the tomato sauce toppings and cheese and all basically. And the second will be again like a pizza delivered. In this case, they are delivering a pizza, so only you need to have a dining table and soda. And the best one is there in terms of the managing or the getting the work on our head, or the getting have an overhead on our side. We can go and have a software as a service. So there we can go ahead and have a dined out where we can go ahead and just pay it and have the pizza over there. So here that effort on our side will be very minimal basically. The similar example is like a car as a service. So in this, we can have a traditional where we are going to have the car, where we need to manage each and everything on our side, like a car, finance, depreciation, servicing, renewables, insurance, road tax, garage, fuel, road tour, tolls, and driver. So in this, the problem is that each and everything you are doing it yourself. So you are getting a lot of overhead on your side basically. So the better than that will be like going with the infrastructure as a service. So in this, we can have the car leased. So we need to have only the car finance and the depreciation basically managed by the service provider basically. And the better than the infrastructure is a platform as a service, where that managed by the service provider, they are managing a car for you, finance, depreciation, servicing, renewables, insurance, road tax, and the garage. And the next one will be like a software as a service, where they are going to like a taxi, where they are doing it each and everything for you basically. So ultimately the question still comes, why to go with the cloud basically? So we can go and see that what is our used, right? As per our new use, because if you are going to have the, if you are going to purchase your machine at your side, then you need to have it and you need to manage it. Each and everything is over on your head. Not only that, tomorrow if something better machine is coming or you need to have the next version, then you need to go and scrap the machine. But we do not have certain issues, all these issues into a basically into a cloud. You will be having some better version available there. You can just go and click some buttons and all, and we can go ahead and use it basically. Similarly, we have an example as a house as a service also, where that examples can be build your own home, or that we can go and purchase a house, or we can take it on the rental, or we can stay in the hotel basically. Cloud journey. So the cloud journey started like this, that earlier we had around 20 years before, whenever we were working into industry, we were given a standalone machine. So what will happen that each of the resources, they have a standalone machine and they were working on it. And it will be getting, we were using some VPNs and all for connecting it, or we'll be having some version management tool. At that time in the .NET for that, we were using a Visual Source Safe, or in that and later point of time, we got a telephone, the TFS or Team Foundation Service, and now we have got a VSTS basically. Later point of time, in on cloud on premises only, we have got the next version which is like virtualized. So what was happening, they were having that virtualization in the place and they were having certain servers and all, and for using it optimum so that the different person from the different time zone, they can go ahead and use it or share the resources basically. So that's why the virtual machines on the on premises. Now the next phase came into a infrastructure service, where we started getting a virtual machines. So in this case, what was happening that whatever we were doing into the on-premises, the similar work got started into a public cloud provider like an Azure or the AWS started doing the similar activity for us. So in this case, what will happen? They will be having some data centers where they'll be having a servers and all, and they could have created different virtual machines and all, which is like a sharing model. They could have created it, and we are going to use it, or we are using it basically. So again, whatever we are doing at the smallest scale into the on-premises, the similar work they could have done at the very large scale for us. So that was the infrastructure as a service. Now coming back to the platform as a service, the platform as a service for creating a website, Azure has come with the next offering, which is a platform as a service called Azure Cloud Services, which was having the worker process for doing some background activity, as well as that the Azure role services, they have it, which is for the creating a website basically. So we're having a two part. The next part of that, next point of time in the portal.azure.com, which is the new portal or the ARM portal. So which like they have came with the next offering, which is called that web apps basically. So where in web apps is basically, it's a part of Azure app services, where we can go ahead and create some web app where the scalability, authentication and all is very easy basically. Within no time we can go and create a web app, and we can go ahead and have the scalability into the place, or we can use the authentication Azure Active Directory and all, and it's really very easy to use with Office 365 and all basically. The next version came with Azure, which is again a platform as a service, which is like a service fabric. So Azure Service Fabric is basically a microservices offering from the Azure side basically. So in this case, it's a microservices where we could have broken our application, our monolithic application, into the microservices, and we can go ahead and reap the lot of benefit of the microservices. Like we can have the services which will be very micro into the size, and we can go and interact with the using the REST API and all, and we can have the multiple other benefits of the microservices concept. The next one came with Azure Cloud Service, Azure Container Service, which is now called AKS actually. So AKS is again a microservices offering from the Azure, which is having the portability, like we can go ahead and develop an application over there, and we can have a containerized approach over there. So today we can go ahead and have an application developed over there, and we can take this application to the GCP, Google Cloud Platform, or we can take it to the some other cloud provider, IBM or AWS and all basically. So multiple times client may be willing to go with Azure Container Service so that the client may not have to hook to the any of the cloud provider basically. The next one came with FAS, which is Azure Function, one of the examples. Basically, Azure is having this called the serverless technology. In this one, they have three services currently supported, which is again is a platform as a service. So in this, we have three services offering basically from Azure, which is called the Azure Functions, Event Grid, as well as the Logic Apps basically. So again, Azure Function is for storing a piece of the code, which we can go ahead and use it for performing any task over there. Again, the similar thing will be like Azure Logic Apps. So Logic Apps where we can have a different connectors and all, and we can get a data from one format to another format basically. So we can get a data, just to think that we wanted to get a data from the, we can go and get from the service SharePoint portal, SharePoint online or SharePoint portal, and we can dump this data into Azure Data Lake, or you wanted to send it to the on-premise. So using the different connectors and all, we can use into the Logic Apps basically. Similarly, for the event purpose, we have a Event Grid also. So these are the way our cloud journey has gone. And already in the beginning, we have seen the cloud journey with the passage of the years basically. So why to use the cloud basically? What all the benefits are there for using the clouds? So the cost, one of the strong factor why we wanted to go with the cloud. So it's like a CapEx and OpEx basically. So here what will happen when you are working on the on-premises, we are having a capital expenditure. So probably you need to go and purchase some server and pay a huge chunk of money. You need to go ahead and manage the complete infrastructure. You need to have your own small kind of data center or the server room. You need to manage electricity for it. You need to manage the cooling system for it. You need to have the certain number of the person to support 24/7. You need to have a database administrator or the different defragmentation, different tasks you need to perform it. So basically, if you see any of the company, that is not the primary job of them basically. They are not meant for it. So just you think that any of the company you are taking for which is running a car services, right? So their job is to perform much better into a car running or performing any service basically, right? That is the specification they have. So many of the startups, they wanted to go with them. They wanted to go ahead and use such services only, which is like starting an applications on the cloud itself only. Not even that, one of the bank is there in Australia. They don't have, neither they have a branch, nor they have any, infrastructure support basically, nor they have any office or the server rooms. They have each and everything on the cloud, and they are doing everything on the virtually. They are running this completely. So in this case, what will happen? They will be putting all the effort to upgrade themselves into the banking domain basically. They wanted to do much better into that. So that, and whereas in the, this operational expenses, we can see that pay and use. So as much as you are going to use this service, we can go ahead and use it basically. Not only that, in the CapEx, the next challenge is there that if you are using that type of any type of the server, if the next version is required and if it is coming in the market, we need to scrap it. And the, whatever the investment could have done, it could have gone for toss basically. So in this way, always it is go to better to go with the OpEx, or we can go with the cloud, so that if currently my offering is not meeting my requirement, like if you are having any standard one, we like S1, S2 or something like this, whatever you have and better, we can go ahead and just click the button. So just to think that I require to have a 60 numbers of the user support, I can go to a standard with S0 type of SQL, I can go. I'm looking for the 90 sessions there, I can go with S1. I'm looking for 120, I can go with S2 basically. So similar way, we can go ahead and just click some buttons, or we can go ahead and configure it and get something better than that, whatever we have it basically. The speed. So again, basically the speed is the same example that you wanted to get something much better than that, then we can go ahead and just click certain buttons and all within some minutes and all, we can go ahead and provision it and all basically. So I can give an example basically why to go for the cloud. Basically, I was working with a company where they wanted to run one of the application for the survey management. So the requirement was there to have the 8 GB RAM. So if you are working for a company and enterprises, it's not so easy to get a RAM basically. If you have a 4 GB RAM, getting an 8 GB RAM officially is not so easy basically. So we were moving from pillar to post. We went to ask for the private cloud offering also. That company was having some understanding for the private cloud. They told we will give you a private cloud, but they will be charging up front 21K because the seven, we will only give you for 3 months. And each month it is costing you 7K. So you need to pay 21K upfront to us. And if you are going to use this application for a minute also, hour also, you need to go ahead and pay 21K to us upfront only. So what we happened, we went over there and we took the subscription for the AWS. We have taken a subscription and we went with the T2 large. It was supporting 8 GB of RAM. And we went over there. Within no time, we got an we got EC2 instance up and running and we configured an application. So this is one of the beautiful example for using the cloud basically. Yeah, global scale. So basically that new companies, whenever they are coming, they wanted to go with cloud, and they can have a right amount of the IT resources. They can have it, they can have a compute power, storage, bandwidth, and they can be in the different geographic location and all, we can have it basically. So whenever you are looking for whenever you wanted to have the scalability into the place, just within in the web app, right? In the web app is not currently, whatever it is not meeting our requirement, we can go ahead and have it into the different way. There's a three way we can have it, like a fix that. If you know that this time to this time, we are going to have the lot of the bandwidth is required, we can go ahead and have the scalability as a fix that, so that we can have the high amount of the compute power, we can go ahead and have it. So, and we can have a scalability into the horizontal way, or the, we can have in the vertical way also. So if you are curve horizontal, when we can go ahead and have the 20 stance into that, or if you want to have more, we can talk to the, we can have a service provider, we can go and talk to them, we can go ahead and get the number of the instances we can have it, but still horizontal is not going to meet our requirement. We can have the vertical. So just to think the S0 is not meeting, we can go with S1, S2 are much better than that. Excuse me. So such things we can have it over there. Yeah, productivity. So in this, we wanted to meet the business goal. As we told you that any of the company, which is like a petrochemical company, or it is in retail, or it is working into any of the sector, they are the first goal will be there to compete into the market, because the most of the enterprises, they have the policy called cloud first policy, and they will be going ahead and doing the assessment where they can have a different approaches with the different things. So what will happen, they will be doing the consolidation also. They may be taking because the many of the enterprises, they'll be having 100, maybe 1,000, 2,000 application, they'll be having it. So they will go and consolidate it, and they will say that each application should be only run into the Linux or the Windows. These are with the particular flavor basically. So they can go and consolidate it, or they can go ahead and tell that .NET, this particular version is only required, database, this particular version is required. So in this case, what will happen? They are going to do the complete change. They are doing it, and they are making a system into the different way, so that they can go ahead and make any changes and meet the today's requirement basically. Because if they are not doing it, their computer is going to do this, and they will be into the big trouble. That is the reason also we can see that many of the companies or enterprises, they are going with the Office 365 so that they can have Active Directory into the place, or they can Office 365, they can go ahead and have the Outlook, they can have a multi-factor authentication, they can have authentication into the place. And if you have Office 365, within no time, we can go ahead and have multiple benefits with the web app or the multiple services, we can go ahead and use it basically. So we can have much productivity if you are using the cloud basically. Performance. So if you are using the cloud, definitely we'll be having the latest generation of the services, we'll be having it, and we can save the money also. So as well as whenever required, we can have this. We're talking about the web app. So we can have a web app, we can have some automatic scalability. So just you think that I have a 10 number of the instances I have, then we can have a rule over there. If the utilization of the resources is more than 40%, create some 20% extra. So that will become 12 or maybe 15, or we can write the number of the instance to be increased. If the number of the resources is more than the 80%, we can go ahead and again increase the number of the instances in the similar way to reduce the consumption also, or to save the money also. We can have the different way we could have the automation into the place, so that we can reduce the, if the number of the resources is less than 80%, we can go ahead and reduce the number of the instances by 20%, or the similar way if the utilization of the resources is less than the 10%, we can again go ahead and reduce the number. So in this way, we can go ahead and have the performance better. Reliability. So one of the reason to go with Azure or any other cloud provider is reliability. So what will happen, that you don't need to handle the data backup, you don't have to handle the disaster recovery. They could have done each and everything, they could have used it. Just you need to go ahead and pay and use it. So we just to think that I'm using a blob services basically. So blob is having a different way of a disaster recovery. We can have the instances into the different country. We can have a high availability into the place. We can have the into the different region. We can go ahead and have it. So different way we can go ahead and have the reliability into the place. So always, whenever we go to an enterprise or we visit our client, they will be asking this question: is cloud secured? Yeah, definitely cloud is secured. The reason we can justify it, that government clouds are there in the US, China, AWS is having the government cloud, or the restricted cloud, I can say, into China basically. So we can have the different ways where we can go ahead and have the security into the place. We'll start with infrastructure service. We can go and have an infrastructure service. We can have a virtual network. So virtual network into the place. What will happen? That's to think we have a company. So company can have a VNet for VNet, virtual network for the HR. They can have for the supply chain management. For the different sectors or the divisions, they can have the virtual network into the place. And that virtual network is nothing but like our LAN actually. So the way we safeguard our interest of the LAN, similar way we can have a VNet over there, where we can go ahead and have our security. We could have written it, or we could have done it for us, and we could have used it basically. So the next one is like Active Directory. So here the Active Directory, we can have the way we have our Active Directory into the on-premises, the similar way we can have a Azure Active Directory over there into the cloud, where we can have our users, we can have our groups into the place, and we can go ahead and use it basically. Key Vault basically. So Key Vault is nothing but wherever you wanted to store information, you wanted to keep certain secret information all, then we can go ahead and use the Key Vault basically. Transport layer security, wherever you wanted to communicate a data from the on-premises to the cloud, we can use the transport layer security to have a security into the place for the data flow. And so single sign-on. So multiple times where the client wanted, just to think you're working in a company, will be having an home page. The home page will be having the different different pages and all, so we can just go ahead and click it. So we can go and use the, again, Azure Active Directory, and we can have a single sign-in to the place. Not only that, we can have the access panel where the client can go and a user can go and just log in, and whatever the application in Azure, they could have added it over there, they can go ahead and see it at one place. And multi-factor authentication. So
Okay, I think Prayesh has got disconnected. I'll just try to see if we can get him back online. Just hold on. Please bear with us for a moment.
We had a system issue. So we can have a multi-factor authentication into the place, because whenever you're working with an enterprises, they wanted to have the application as a very secured one. So these are one of the facility which we have into Office 365, where we can have a multi-factor. So it's like a two-way authentication. So in this way, we can go ahead and have the, first of all, we can have the single sign-on also, where they don't have to enter the credential. The second place will be there. We can get a OTP into our mobile. We can go ahead and enter it, or we can have some app installed into our mobile where we can go ahead and just accept, click and accept it. Or we can, so these are the way we can have multi-factor authentication. But sometime what will happen that some of the company or enterprises, they will not be permitting you to use your mobile, or they will not permit you to use your laptop. They'll be having some standalone machine where in the lab or the restricted place, we need to get inside, and still you wanted to have the multi-factor authentication. In that case, what will happen that we will be whitelisting the IP address from the machine. And if the IP address is coming from that particular machine, then we can go and authenticate it basically, like auto-authentication. And the next one, like HTTPS, so we'll be having the secured site created, and we can have the secured website over there. The next one is transparent data encryption. So wherever you have data and all, we can have a transparent data encryption into the place. Not only that, basically, wherever you are using the pass, PaaS will be having the different ways of having the security. Like in blob, we can have a SAS into the place. When you are using the Azure Data Factory, we can have POSIX actually. So POSIX, what will happen? POSIX. So where we can give a particular, Azure Data Lake, we can give an access to the particular user on the read, write, and perform or different activity or execute. So we can have a different way. We can go ahead and have into the place, into the platform as a service, where it's coming back again to the infrastructure service. We can have a VNet into the place, and we can define our entire rule and all. If one VNet is interacting with another VNet, we can have a VNet peering into the place. Or if you wanted to have the, we can have the subnet, or we can have the, we can have different way. We can have our own security implemented into the basically VNet. So these are the way we can go ahead and have the security into the place basically. So in other words, when the government is trusting multiple banks and all, they have the data, or the different companies, they have already trusted the cloud computing and they are happy basically. So if any issue is there, most of the time, if any failure is there, then it is not due to the cloud. It can be, we could have not configured high availability into the place. If any region is having a downtime, we can have the data into, or we can have the similar services, parallel services into a paired region, or into the other geographical places we can have it. So these are the way we can meet the high availability or the disaster recovery. Questions. So these are the questions which we always hear it basically. Can we have an existing application? Can we have a SaaS, PaaS, and infrastructure service? So basically, I had been to entertainment company, to entertain media entertainment company. They had an application which I written under the WPF basically, which is a thick client application from the Microsoft basically. So they asked us to give an all the approaches to have this application migrated to the SaaS, PaaS, and IaaS basically. So in this case, so we have asked them to go and use that for like basically a supply chain management application. So we have asked them to go and use the Demantra or Kinexys or the JDA. These are the three softwares which were they have it and they were getting used with their the counterpart also or the competitors also into the industry. The next way was there for them to scratch the application. Scrap the application and we can go ahead and use this application. We could have used the MVC.NET and they could have used the .NET Core application. We could have been able to run it on the Windows as well as the Windows as well as the Linux basically. So that was the PaaS approach we have given it to them. The next one was their infrastructure service basically. So infrastructure service in this case, the option was there for them to install this application or this EXE basically into a, one of the VM. And this VM, they could have downloaded it into the ClickOnce tool. They could have used it and they could have used it onto the desktop or the laptop basically. So these are the way we could have gone and we could have given the proposal to them to upgrade the application or to migrate this application to the different environments basically. The next question is that why to opt for the private cloud? So basically whenever public cloud is not going to meet our requirement, then we go ahead and use the private cloud approach basically. So it can be like a data residency. They cannot keep the data outside the client boundary and all, then we can go ahead and use for the private cloud infrastructure service. So just you think that you wanted to migrate, you wanted to close your own server room. Then you have to do the quick migration. The quick migration can be done in infrastructure service. You have any native development, native language application, then you have to go with infrastructure service. Why to go with platform as a service? In platform as a service, when you wanted to have them, don't want to manage the application, don't want to have the OS upgrade and all. And then definitely we wanted to go with platform as a service basically. Why to opt for the software as a service? In software as a service, they could have built it and we are can go ahead and just use it basically paying on that. But if SaaS is not meeting the requirement, then we go with platform as a service basically. Because if you wanted to have any of the application which is not available into the market, right? Then we can go and have the software as a service. Not only that, if you have any application developed by you and you don't, it is having certain functionality. Just you think I worked in a company where they have done a .NET application and the 300 people they have worked it. So they will definitely not be interested to scrap this application where people they could have worked in decade because they could have the functionality which they could have added. Probably they may not be getting into the certain SaaS provider. So we can go with PaaS, platform as a service. The similar way, infrastructure service also. If PaaS is not going to meet my requirement, like earlier, we were working on one of the applications which were required to use a SQL Service Broker and that was not available into the Azure SQL V12. Then we need to go with infrastructure service. The next one is that why to go with a native development? Just you think you have any application to develop it and it's a new requirement. So whenever any you are working with any of the company or the they'll be having something called cloud first. So definitely they wanted to go with the native development. So they will be doing the complete application development itself on the cloud. Probably they can go with a web app to have a website. They can have a database into SQL V12. They can keep certain data into the SQL. They can keep into Azure Data Lake. Or they wanted to have some data with a massive parallel processing. They can have into SQL DW and all. So these are the reasons we go ahead and use native developments. So do we have any questions?
Prayesh, I'll just share all the questions in the chat box. I've noted all of them, so I'll just share it and you can address them one by one. Sure. A moment.
Sure, sounds good to me. Thank you.
Okay, just a moment. I'll put this to you. Okay, these are a few questions which I have put in, and I'll share a few more. So you can, are you able to see the questions, Prayash?
Can you please help me how to go ahead and see
the questions? If you can click on chat, you should be able to view the questions.
Give me a minute. I can see question and answer participant.
Or do you, can you see the chat icon at, it's right next to the share box?
I can see question and answer, which I've already clicked it.
Okay, so there are questions posted there as well. Probably you could start with those.
I cannot see that. I can see that. Okay, is it like this? Okay. Okay, the Pius has asked this question. Is Azure Cool Storage is alternative to AWS Glacier? If not, what are the difference between the live usage and the scenarios basically? Yeah, so basically if you see AWS also, they have the certain services depending on the need, where that you can have the data into the place and they can give, you can get a data, just you think that you wanted to do certain archival process and all, they have a services where we can request the data, they can give you in 5 hours availability. So similarly, as per the need, because that if the enterprise required to keep certain data over there, in that way we can go ahead and use the services like this. The cloud is centralized, so if the main server goes down, then doesn't all the data get compromised basically? So this is a question that has been already answered over there. If any, due to whatever reason, if any data, say if any data center is down, then we can have the similar application into other data center basically, so that we can have the disaster recovery, business continuity or availability into the place. So these are the way we go ahead and do that basically. You said is a OpenStack is a private cloud. Does it include all the services same as the public cloud? So definitely, see, the problem is there with the private cloud. So always the public cloud will be having the much facility than the private cloud. So a lot of the services which is there into the available into a public cloud may not be into a private cloud. Just to think the Azure, if we are talking about the Azure public service will be having a lot of services available, whereas we will not be having the many of the services available into a Azure stack basically. So do we have any other question? Open one. How secure is our application giving to a service provider? Can the service provider change our application? So see what happened, that when we have any of our application into a cloud, so what will happen, we'll be having our database or you're keeping any of the application, then they cannot go ahead and see the, they cannot go and see the data over there. Not only that, whenever we are working with the enterprise company, we can go and give them only the subscription ID to them. They can go and understand it. But not only that, they cannot go ahead and see any of your data basically. So in that case, we need to go ahead and use the Skype for Business to share our screen with them. They can ask you certain data which you cannot give it because if it is a confidential or not. So you need to work with them and then you need to try to get the support level. And always the support level provided by Azure is far better than any cloud basically.
Prayash, I have shared all of the questions on your WhatsApp as well. So if you take a look at that, you'll be able to see all the questions which have been posted by everyone till now.
Okay, give me a minute. Just I'll be doing that. Okay. Sindhu has asked this question. What is private cloud? What does it... private cloud, what does it take to start a private cloud? So basically, again, answer is same only. Wherever we cannot go and use the public cloud because your data is very sensitive, and as per our company policy, they'll be having the different PII level basically, which the company could have defined it. They will say this PII level data, we can we cannot keep it into the our outside the country boundary. Not only that, some of the country will be having their own rule that customer data or the details of the customer, we cannot keep into the other countries and all. In that case, we need to go with the private cloud basically. Now, Misrav has asked this question. I think PaaS should be a subset of IaaS and SaaS should be a subset of PaaS. No, just I'm making it very clear. SaaS is a superset of PaaS and PaaS is a superset of IaaS basically. So basically in infrastructure service, you are only giving the infrastructure there, but they are providing a kind of hardware to them, right? Where in platform as a service, they could have, they are giving you hardware as well as they are managing the complete service for you. So basically, whenever you wanted to get the complete control on your side, we wanted to go with infrastructure service. But if you're not getting it, then don't want certain things, we can go with platform as a service basically. So more control, it means you have to come from SaaS to PaaS and then from PaaS to IaaS basically. So is YouTube, Facebook also SaaS? Also, one more thing for the development sake, do we have any free services for IaaS, PaaS, or do we have any need to purchase it? Yeah, so basically coming back to this, we don't know how this YouTube and the Facebook and they are the, how they have managed it. No doubt, definitely I can say that Google.com is basically using the microservices and they have a DevOps into the place and they are able to manage it very fast. Now coming back to this, we have a Azure subscription. We can go ahead and provide our number and we can provide our the credit card, unique credit card, which is like one time use only number and mobile number. And we can provide the credit card, which they will be deducting a ₹2 in India and $1 in US just for the authentication purpose, authenticate a user, and they will give it reverting back to you, reverting this money to you. And we can get a subscription for 1 month basically. So in this 1 month, you can go ahead and they will give you around 13,200 in Indian currency as well as or $200 into the US currency. We can go ahead and use the this currency for our learning purpose basically. Greece has asked, demand aggregation is a boon or bane? Curse or cloud storage providers, basically. Demand aggregation is a boon or bane. So I'm unable to understand this question. If we can rephrase it, it will be much better for us to understand it. The next question is by Pius. How hybrid cloud in Azure versus hybrid cloud in AWS? What is Azure stack? So basically, as per my understanding, Azure is AWS is not having any private cloud offering, whereas Azure, we have Azure public cloud as well as Azure, a private cloud, which is called Azure Stack basically. Can we call Azure Data Lake Analytics as a serverless service? No, Azure Data Lake is not a serverless service. It is just a storage service basically. So the why we go with Azure Data Lake, the reason of using the Azure Data Lake is there that we can have the all type of data, which is structured, data, which can like a table storage and all, we can have the data over there. Or like we can have the data into the Notepad, into the CSV, or we can have a semi-structured data, which is like a JSON data, we can have into that. Or like we can have the unstructured data also into that. So these are the reasons we go ahead and use Azure Data Lake. And always for the analytics purpose, Azure Data Lake is preferred. No doubt Azure Data Lake Gen 1 only we are talking, but if you are going with Azure Data Lake Gen 2, then we can go ahead and get the benefit of the blob as well as ADL Gen 1 also, which is like a superset of ADL Gen 1 or the combination of ADL Gen 1 as well as Gen 2. The next question is from the Swapnil is there. With SaaS, can a business firm be free from the bothering about the software solution to their in business with a completely focusing on their core operation? Yes, this is the beauty of the using the SaaS. So always the client may be willing to go with software as a service, but if they cannot go, then they go with platform as a service or infrastructure as a service. Because any of the company has to focus on their core business rather than taking care of the some other services. The next question is from the Pius is that how to provide the scripts to runbook into the ARM template while deploying a template into an Azure using the Azure AG CLI basically. So basically it will be the part of the DevOps and all basically. So like in Azure Data Factory, we can go ahead and have Azure Data Factory. We could have developed it and we can have a ARM template into the place and we can get into the, just you think you are working into the development resource group. You can have taken next resource group into a UA to a production and we can go ahead and execute it. This is like a manual way, but you can have a DevOps project into the place and we can have a pipeline created into that. The next question is that from the Shivam, how data security is provided into the cloud platform? So basically this, we have already covered it over there. And that was our last slide, which we have already spoken. And not only that, the expenditure into the Azure, into a cloud, is in $1 billion basically. It is not like other products, but it is much more than that. Pius, is Azure Cool Storage alternative to AWS Glacier? If not, what are the difference between the live usage and scenarios? So I'm not aware about the Azure AWS Glacier basically. So cannot compare it. Cloud is centralized. So if the next question is from Anant basically, cloud is centralized. So if the main server goes down, then doesn't all the data get compromised? This we have already answered it. We have next question from Welcome 2070. You said is OpenStack is a private cloud. That is include all the services same as, but this also we have already answered it earlier. Next question is from the Swapnil. How secure is our application giving into a service provider? Already answered, anonymous attendee. It's not related to Azure. Curious to know what is the difference between OpenStack and OpenShift. So basically I feel, to be very frank, I am not aware about the OpenShift. But OpenStack is definitely a cloud offering for the private cloud. So do we have any other questions?
No, that is all we have for today, and that is also all the time we have for today. I think we'll have to take our leave. I just wanted all you all to know that I'll be sharing the recording of this webinar, so you can go through it once again, and if you have any questions, you can definitely mail them back to me. I will definitely have Prayesh go through them and get it across to all of you. Also, we have a very special session coming on the 29th about UI frameworks, the details of which I will be sharing with you all very soon. So thank you all for joining us for today's session, and I hope to see you all again on the next one, which is on the 29th of August. Thank you, everyone, and thank you, Prayesh.
Thank you, everyone, for joining. Thank you. Bye.